Our next speaker is Narendra. He is coming from booking.com, where he is front-end developer. So welcome, Narendra. The stage is yours.
Hello? Yeah. Yes. Hello, everyone. Thank you for coming. I know it's a little difficult competition to have it with the food. A lot of people are just coming in, so thank you for coming in early. As you know, my talk is all about let your users decide what they want. I think everyone here would be building on some products, some websites, or something on that sort, and you always come across one situation where you would have to take a call whether this feature has to go live, the way of it has been built, the UI, the UX, how the user journey happens. So you always come into that discussion, and the main important thing has to be done is you have to bring that decision to the users, right? And give the users all the options which you are thinking, and let the users decide which one stays on the product, right? So that's what I'll be mostly talking about. I'll be talking about how it is done, why you should do it, and when you should not do it. To start off, to introduce myself, I'm Narendra. I work as a front-end developer at booking.com. We have our headquarters in Amsterdam, and that's where I'm based off. How many of you here have used booking.com for your stay? Nice. And people who didn't use, please use it. It's a good product. We do a lot of A/B testing. And on the internet, you might be knowing me for some of the animations which I do on React and React Native, some transitions using animated and stuff. And this is also my interested topic. So if you have anything to talk about transition, animation, catch me. So yeah, I'll be happy to discuss on that. OK, so let the slide change. Yes. OK, so as I'm talking about A/B testing, so when I said let your users decide what they want, the main here is the concept of A/B testing, right? How many of you know what A/B testing is? OK. And how many of you have used A/B testing? OK. I hope after this talk, people who didn't raise your hands, go back and start implementing A/B testing at your work. And yeah, that's something which I'm looking forward to. So what is A/B testing? To give them in a small definition, A/B testing is running experiments to optimize your customer experience. So whatever changes you do on your website, it could be UI changes, it could be features, it could be technical changes, the end goal is always to improve the customer experience. And by doing that, you want to improve the business metrics, right? So end goal, if it's an e-commerce company, you want to make more bookings. If it's something else, you want more signups. The end goal, you always want the business to benefit. But meanwhile, you also want to improve the customer experience. And A/B testing really helps in doing that. To give you an example, let's say you have two UIs, two screens of the landing page, where the only change here is the button color, right? And what you do is you divide the traffic into two buckets, the A and the B. And in a same time, same duration, you expose the users to A and B. And then you measure which one converted better, right? And if A converted better, you keep the A as the default one for all the users. If B converted better, then you give all the users the new screen. So that's basic of A/B testing. You have two things you have to decide with, A and B, and you give both the things to the users, and then let the users decide whether which one they have to go with. Why A/B testing? So the main reason is we are most of the time wrong about what we think is good, right? All of us here in this room are wrong most of the time. Which you think is good for the users is not really true, right? And how do you know whether it is good or not? By putting that out to the users. And by doing that, you do A/B testing and you measure an impact. You measure the impact and then you decide whether it's really good for the users. And main important thing, we want whatever changes you do has to be profitable, right? Our product should improve and it should improve the way that it serves the business needs. That's very important, right? We would always, I'm a developer, a front-end developer who works in Amsterdam, and I look at a product in a very different way. Maybe the users don't see this product in the same way, right? So we are not the majority of your product users. So we would like the website to do things we think is great and matches the way we use the website. Like I said, that tend not to represent the entire user group. So it's very important to A/B test and test whether it really worked. We want our customer sentiment to drive product development. This is very simple. It's like customers like what they're seeing, then you give more of that. If they don't like certain things, then you give less of that. And how do you know which one the customer likes and which one does not? It's only by A/B testing. And we want to make product decision based on the fact. So let's say, for an example, you have your manager, your product manager, your CEO comes tomorrow and tells you to make a logo bigger, right? And why are you doing it? The only way to find out whether that really works is measuring the old logo and the new logo and to see which one did really improve. So there is no gut feeling here. There is nothing like my word against yours. So you have no basis. So data really helps you decide whether you have to go with A, the base, or the B. So it's based on the fact. That's what I'm saying. And very important, it helps you to learn. By learn, I mean it helps you learn the product. It helps you learn your users, their behavior. It helps you understand your entire user base and how they use the product. And that helps you decide which feature and how the feature has to be implemented. When I'm talking about why you should use A/B testing, it's very important to talk about why not. And very important thing is when you don't have sufficient traffic. In booking.com, we have enough traffic to say that every small change with high statistical significance, right? And this particular, and I could be very certain and reliable that my experiment is valid, right? And this reliability degrades as your traffic degrades. So it's very important to see how much of your users are exposed to certain experiment to really see the impact. But again, if you plan the A/B testing in a way where you learn from that and not take these crucial decisions, you could still use it even if you have low traffic. But it really helps and it really works very well if you have large amount of traffic to do small changes. Your success metrics are ill-defined. By that, I can give an example. For us, for booking.com, our metrics, the key metrics is very simple. We should get more reservation and get less cancellation. That's it. So if you don't have this key metrics for your business, it's very difficult to run an A/B testing. Like, for example, end of your cycle of 2 weeks of running the experiment, you'll have a page full of data. Some things have gone up, some things have gone down, and that doesn't really help you take a decision. But if you have a key metric which says bookings have gone up, the conversion, you could always be certain that if the booking goes down, no matter any other metrics, I will not make this for all the users. So you need to have this key metrics which helps you take that key decisions. And most importantly, you like being an expert. If you like being an expert, don't do A/B testing because you would be wrong most of the times and you look like an idiot. But lucky for you, everyone in your team would look like an idiot. So again, if you like being an expert, if you want your word to be put out there, then yes, don't do A/B testing. Process of A/B testing. So I spoke about what, why, and why not. Let me get into the how you structure your A/B testing. There are a couple of steps which we need to do. One is start with an hypothesis. What is an hypothesis? Hypothesis is something like an idea, but it is not an idea. Like, ideas are cheap, ideas are easy, but ideas does not come with any limitation. So it can be like, change the color of the button. That's the idea. But why are you doing it? What are you expected to do out of it? How much, which metrics are supposed to increase, which one should reduce? So that's not idea. So hypotheses are grounded in reality with the business needs, right? So the hypothesis, the only idea of hypothesis is to prove or disprove a certain idea. So if you have something, let's say I have changing my copy, my text to something else, and I'm expecting more signups. So that's hypothesis. So you need to have a stronger hypothesis every time before you start an experiment. It's very important to have the hypothesis like, I'm doing a certain change, and I'm expecting to improve certain things for the users. And I would see certain metrics would increase or certain metrics would decrease. So that's your entire hypothesis. It's very important to have that before you start any experiment. Once you have an hypothesis, you define the metrics. So What is the metrics? So based on your hypothesis, if you have to prove or disprove the hypothesis, you need a metrics. And that's the key metrics, right? And for an e-commerce company, for any e-commerce company, it's pretty simple. We have to make a lot of money. And that's our key metrics. If we get more bookings, if we get less cancellation, that's our key metric, right? And you could categorize the metrics in broadly two categories, shallow metrics and deep metrics. By shallow, I can say that I change a button color and I get more clicks on the button, right? But the deep metrics meaning I get more clicks, but the user end up making more bookings, or the user end up signing up for some plans. So that's deep metrics. So you can have the entire flow of the user. So depending on the type of experiment you're running, it could be shallow metrics, which you could set as key metrics, or the deep metrics. After you have your hypothesis and the metrics decided, then you design and implement. So then you implement the changes, then you split the traffic into two, and then you put it out for the users. And then you run it for like 2 weeks. We run it for 2 weeks to get the nice sample size, but it could be various different number of visitors. Based on that, you run for month, a week, or based on that. And then you measure, you learn. So you get the data, you get the result from what you're running. And based on the result, you learn that users have behaved in a certain way. It could be that the variant didn't go full on, but you saw some other metrics improving or some other metrics degrading. So you learn from that experiment and you rerun the experiment with a stronger hypothesis. So now your hypothesis will be like, based on my previous experiment, I saw certain things happening. And now I'm doing this change because I'm expecting this to happen. So now you have a nice case study backing your current experiment. So experiment is all about, it gets stronger and stronger as you run the same experiments with a better understanding of the users. So the entire A-B testing is like a cycle. The first cycle will be a weak hypothesis, I would say, and then it gets better and better. This is something which we have all over our at office at work. So 90% of the times what we run, what we think is good for the users, we fail. What we think this will make more money or this will help the users, it does not do so. And it's sometimes you don't know why certain things failed. And that's the most frustrating part, right? And it's very important, as like I was mentioning key metrics, it's very important to have certain secondary metrics, which helps you understand whether the user behaved in a very different way, why, what happened. Like a page load could have increased, bounce rate would have increased. These are not your key metrics, but these are supporting metrics. And when you look into that, that tells you why your experiment failed or why it succeeded. To give you an example, this is a search result page of booking.com in tablet. A while back, we were having our images in the search result page in as 150 pixel square, right? And that was not really clear. So what we wanted to do was we want to run an experiment making a higher quality image and to see how the user would behave and to see whether we'll get more bookings or not. So that was the base of this. And we had a couple of discussions and various implementations. And then we had like 200 pixel, 300 pixel. And then we decided to run the variant with 500 pixel square, right? And what we did, it was simple change. We just changed the source of the image to another one when it is in variant. And we run the experiment for 2 weeks for A and B with 150 and 500 pixel. How many of you think A performed better, the base performed better? I see one hand up there. How many of you think 500, the B variant would have performed better? Okay. And people who didn't raise your hand, what do you think? It's neutral or you didn't see the results? Actually, you're right, because we didn't see any strong signal which would say A is better or B is better. And again, like I said, this is the worst scenario to be in, because you don't know whether the user like 150 pixel, it's a better quality image, why the users are not doing better. And then we had a couple of secondary metrics, and what we saw is increase in page load. Because we had a bigger image, it took a little bit more time to load the page, which kind of neutralized the extra bookings we would have got. So people who would have seen the search result page earlier, faster, would have seen it in a little delay or a slower network, would have not seen it for some time, and they would have dropped off. And increase in page load kind of neutralized it. So what we did is we re-ran this experiment with 150 pixel and 300 pixel. How many of you think now 300 pixel would have done better? A few, nice. And who think 150 would have given a stronger signal? The same one hand, I guess. Yeah. And who thinks it's still neutral? Very few. Yes, the 300, the B did better. And now, like you see, the hypothesis got stronger on the second one. It's mainly because you understood how the users are behaving and how the product is behaving, and then you improve based on that. So this is one of the examples why I wanted to say is how the secondary metrics is very important for you to understand other things changing when you're making a small changes like this. A-B testing processes work very differently for web and native, the mobile I'm talking about. To give an example, let's start with web. Web, you have an idea. Let's say you have an idea on the in the morning, you build it by afternoon, and you deploy it. And by the end of the day, you will have users coming to your experiment. Like, so the deployment process is pretty quick. So you could start with an idea and end the day with the users seeing your changes. But in native, it's very different. You have an idea in the morning. It starts with a similar process. You build it by afternoon. But you have, based on your submission process, it could take 1 week to 2 weeks, what the cycle of your app submission is. You wait for 2 weeks without doing nothing, and then you submit the app. But then again, it takes 2 to 3 days for reviewing by the App Store or the Play Store. So it takes that, and then it gets reviewed, and then you wait for another 2-3 days to get it stable, right? You don't start the experiment immediately. You want the existing thing running smoothly as possible. So you wait for the other 2-3 days, and then you get the user. So it typically approximately takes 3 weeks in native world, and this could be reduced in various ways. Like code push is another thing where you send the update over the air and stuff like that. But the biggest challenge here is you started the hypothesis, and by the time you get, the users see your change, your hypothesis might have changed. You would have seen some other data. You would have thought, OK, maybe this experiment would not work. So it's a long period of time for you to wait, right? And also, the worst case, you have a bug in the experiment. Then you start the process all over again. So it's like a small change could take 1 month to 2 months to push it on the native world. But it's very different on the web. So I'm going to talk a little more on the native side of it. Because it's a little complicated, as I said, and I'm going to talk a little bit on the implementation part as well as we go. Okay, let's say we go on and then we send the app to the App Store, the user downloads the app, they have it, and when they try to open it, you see this splash screen, right? Any app you try to open it, that's the first screen you take. So how do you implement this is, during the splash screen is loading, you ask the server to give me all the experiment settings, right? Which are the experiments you are running and all of that. And you got to be very careful because the splash screen can be from 200 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds. And that's the amount of time your server should respond back. You should not delay the users from not seeing the app because you're trying to improve. The whole idea of A-B testing is to improve the user experience, and that should not stall the user from experiencing your app, right? And then when the server responds, it comes back. So this is the basic structure of how A-B testing could work in a mobile world. And going forward, I'll be using Optimizely as the example. Optimizely is a third-party company which helps you do A-B testing. You can use it right away today. And we don't use Optimizely at booking.com. We have our own tool. But I'm going to use Optimizely as an example as we go on. So like I said, the app requests for the experiment settings. The experiment settings can be as simple as this, where it gives the experiment what the ID, the name of the experiment, and the different variations, right? And Optimizely provides an SDK where you could pass this settings, which is coming from the server to the SDK. And this SDK provides an entire API structure, which could help you decide to start the experiment, to show whether the user goes to base or the variant, and based on that. Like I said, there are two APIs very important which you need to think about, is activate and track. Let's talk about activate. Activate is basically to see if the experiment is in base or the variant. So what you do is you pass the experiment name. It could be experiment one, and then the identifier, which uniquely identifies the user. It could be the user's device, user ID, signed up any of those things, because once a user comes back to the app again, you have to not change the experience. It has to be the same flow. Only then your experiment would be valid, right? And internally, it does a very simple thing. It has the same logic of making the decision whether the user goes to the base or the variant, based on how many users were already in the base, because it has to be split equally. And then the variant has been served, right? And then it makes a call to the server to tell that, OK, we got one user on the base, or we got one user on the variant. And the track is very similar. You want to track how many people click on the button, right? So after the user sees A or B, you click, you trigger an experiment .track, client instance .track, and the event name and the experiment name, which just tells the server that the user clicked on the button. It's a goal which you're tracking. Internally, it does nothing but telling the server that the particular event happened, and you just return it. In React's world, I'm going to use the context API. How many of you know what React is? OK. You don't have to worry if you don't know React, because I'm going to talk about the context, the concept of it. So you don't have to worry. So I'm going to use this create context. So the idea of context is very simple, that you set a certain parameters on the top level, and then you get those data anywhere in the app. So that's like setting the context and then accessing the context. If you're not familiar with React, it's OK. You don't have to get deep into it. The idea is just that I'm setting the context with the instance which I created earlier. And then anywhere in the code, I can just access the context by consumer API. So what I'm doing here is very simple. I'm checking the activate, the function which I earlier showed, getting the decision whether the decision is variant or not. If the decision equal to variant, then the variant has been produced, else the base has been produced, right? So as you can see, most of the things is done on the client, the decision making, the showing which one which the user gets and everything. But it gets really complicated if you want to divide the users equally in a way. English-speaking users goes equally between base and variants. People coming from India goes equally between base and variant. People from US goes from base and variant equally. Then the language, then the platforms. So everything, if has to be divided equally, then it gets really tricky to do it on the client side. So instead of getting the experiment settings from the server, you can directly get the experiment variants. That is, the server decides whether the user goes to base or variant. All the logic goes to the server. And then here, you just get a very simple thing where it says that this experiment, the user is in base. This experiment two, it's on variant, and something like that, right? And it's pretty straightforward. The activate and the track API, which I just showed a little earlier, entirely changes, and it all depends on the object which you received earlier. It's the same context API which I was showing you earlier. So nothing changes in the whole. But the only thing changes here is instead of getting the experiment settings, you get directly the variance. The decision moves to the server. Coming back to the diagram which I was showing. So let's say there is a delay in the experiment variance from the server. The server is down. But in that case, you should not hold on to the users showing the splash screen. You should go on showing the app, because the most important thing is the user experience, right? And that should not spoil. So what you do is you would have the older version of what the experiment setting was. You'll fall back to it, but you'll still continue showing the app. You would not change any of that. So you got to handle things, all of that, even if the first call fails. It could be like the network issue has happened. The server is not responding, or there's no internet connection. Then you still have to go past the splash screen and show it. So the first API may halt you, but you have to make sure that that's not stopping the user from experiencing your app. That's the basic of the entire implementation. I will just go on to the bit of pitfalls. Common pitfalls are big shot A/B testing. This is something which is seen very, very common. For example, they take the entire website or an entire app and redesign, the redevelop, and the new feature, and completely changed, right? And you could always say that it has improved by X percentage. But the only problem here is that too many things have changed on your app, too many things have changed on your website, and you don't really know why the users have converted better on the variant. It could be that the performance was better. It had nothing to do with the entire design, right? So it's very important to know what kind of changes you are doing and to track accordingly. Otherwise, big testing, then you don't know how to go forward after that. something has changed entirely, but you don't know what has impacted what. So big shot A-B testing is one of the problem. Fringe A-B testing. Fringe A-B testing is very interesting. Like, for example, you have a product, you have a website, and you do the A-B testing only on the landing page and not on the any other part of your website. And that's a problem because you have optimized your landing page, but the users are not experiencing the same flow after they land. So you can get more signups, but you will see a lot of drop-offs after that. So it's very important if you're doing A-B testing to do it throughout the funnel, throughout the flow, and not just limit to one part of your website, right? So yeah, that's another pitfall. Assumed reproducibility. It's just a fancy way of saying, if something works for some company, it would work for me as well, right? So it's very important to know that what works for some other company may not work for you. Like, for example, if I'm doing a particular test on the landing page, and I'm doing the same test on the book page, it would not give me the same result because the user behavior would be very different from the landing page to the book page. Even though it's the same kind of user, same website, same experience, but still the user would behave very differently. To give an example, this is an hamburger icon you might have all familiar about. A while back, I think there was a huge debate about saying that these three horizontal bars has no meaning at all. The users don't really care at all. So what we did, we ran it as an experiment. And we ran this for a couple of weeks, just changing the hamburger to menu and to see how the users would have behaved, right? How many of you think hamburger, the old one, would have done better, A? Okay, how many of you think B would have done better? Menu. Okay, and people think we didn't get anything, it behaved the same. Wow, there are few. But actually, that's right, nothing happened. Nothing changed. The bookings were same, the cancellation was same, the click-through was the same, all the secondary metrics was everything the same. So what I'm saying here is the whole community were discussing of moving away from the hamburger to that, but the booking.com customer did not impact the booking.com customers. Pretty much everyone understands what the top left corner is for, and that's a menu which opens the sidebar. But it's not similar for everyone else, like I said. Caffeine Informer is a blog site. They ran a very similar experiment. And they saw a 12% increase when they had a menu with a border, and the drop of 22% when they just had a text menu, right? But what I'm saying here is, it's the same change, nothing else. But it has worked for them, it didn't work for us. So I think this goes on in generally is that what could work for a certain company would not work for you because the users are different, you're targeting different kinds of people, so and different products, different features. So yeah, that's very important. What happens when A-B testings were done right? Right? You test everything. There are pain points in every step of the process, and the whole idea of A-B testing is to remove them. If you're just running the A-B testing landing pages, it will, like I said, and not in other parts of your website, it will not help. So when you test everything, you know how the users are behaving in each steps, and you know what needs to improve and what should not. So you will have a good understanding of the user. Test atomically, which means any change. Whenever we change even a text, a copy, we do an A-B testing. Whenever we change a color of something, we do an A-B testing. I mean, that works for us because we have a lot of users. Any small changes, we would see that. But if it is a small set of users, then you could ignore the atomically. You could do a little broader one. But again, as A-B testing, you get into the culture of that, you start doing everything and atomically. Build tools you can trust. Like I said, Optimizely is a third-party company which helps you do A-B testing. They are great. But like you know, they don't understand your product. They don't understand your user. They don't understand the behavior of your users. And most importantly, the performance. Since these tools are built for everyone, it's very generic. What happens is the performance is something which you will have to go with. Like it could be not that great as you want it to. So as you invest more time in A-B testing, I would recommend you to spend time on building your tool by yourself. So you build a tool which understands the products better and you know what kind of metrics are more important and you track accordingly. And also the way you bucket the user, which user goes to A, which user goes to B, across your apps, mobile apps, web app, same user when they go between these two products, they have to have the same experience and stuff like that. So all of this you could do it once you start building your own tools. Right? But again, if you're starting with A/B testing, you can start off with any of this third-party tool. And then once you think you as a company could start investing more time, you could get on with that. Question when you don't understand. Data is very difficult. I mean, I am really terrible at it. But luckily, I'm surrounded with a lot of people who understand data very well. And that leads me asking more questions about what we need to track, how do we need to track certain things, what's important for tracking for when you're launching certain features. So when you are doing A/B testing in a company, the culture starts coming up with why are we doing certain things. You start looking into the hypothesis. And because that's very important, any feature, anything you're doing, you have to know why you're doing it, what you're tracking, and how you're looking to improve that. So you start questioning everything, and that's very important. And as you go, you build a culture around data-driven, like I said. And any decision you take will be around data, and there'll be no gut feeling. There'll be no my word against yours, and you always go into the meeting or the discussion with the data saying that I'm doing certain changes because I'm expecting this to happen based on the previous data, or this experiment could lead to this. That's all I have about A/B testing. Feel free to reach out to me on Twitter, on anywhere. I'm just around here for the next day as well, and today, of course. Catch me on that, A/B testing, animations, React Native, React, anything you want to talk about, I'll be happy to talk on. Q&A outside. Thank you.